Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mel Brooks' Disobedient Jew by Jeremy Dauber. Narrated by Jeremy Dauber. To Miri, for making me laugh and for laughing. Introduction. Your obedient Jew, Mel Brooks, was how he often signed his letters, and in that signature lies the essential contradiction of his nature. The deep-seated need to be loved, accepted, adopted by all, and the irresistible rebellious urge to take the universal, the standard formula, and to make it funny by making it Jewish. In chronicling Brooks's life, his Jewish life, which in his case amounts to almost the same thing, that same ping-ponging between allegiance and rebellion appears over and over again. Observe the tension between an almost slavish devotion to authority, be that authority classic Hollywood film, Sid Caesar, or 19th-century Russian literature, and the need to remind that authority that a Jewish eye and a Jewish tongue can deflate even the most august of genteel and Gentile structures. In that way, Mel Brooks, more than any other single figure of the 20th century, symbolizes the Jewish perspective on, and contribution to, American mass entertainment. In that way, and many others. Take, for example, his unflagging energy, almost but not quite a mania, and almost but not quite a metaphor for first-generation American Jewish energy. To witness Mel Brooks in any of his television appearances or movie roles is to watch a man incapable of sitting still. He wants to lay waste to the place, to reduce it to ashes in the smoldering fire of his comic genius. But Brooks is no anarchist, no Groucho Marxist. His ultimate decision, following a path so resonant of so many other American Jewish success stories, is that the secret lies in constraining himself within the system rather than working outside of it. Sometimes, those constraints appeared in human form. On the talk shows and variety hours where he first made his name, they appeared in the guise of an interviewer slash straight man to keep him on track, with Carl Reiner, the first among equals, guiding him through his paces in the 2,000-year-old man routines. In his films, the constraints took the form of either stand-ins, Zero Mostel channeling his id in the producers to Gene Wilder's superego, and then Wilder taking turns as both id and superego in Young Frankenstein, or scene partners to balance and bleed off his energy like a safety valve. Think of Madeline Kahn in High Anxiety or Marty Feldman in Dom DeLuise in Silent Movie. Much of this book will tell the story of Brooks's work through his encounters with partners in comedy and art, Jewish and, on occasion, non, a roll call of American 20th century comedy culture. But by far, Brooks's most important self-constraint was his favored form, the parody. He came by his love honestly. The sight of his apprenticeship, Sid Caesar's Your Show of Shows, practically reinvented the form for post-war mass entertainment. But Brooks took it further, making the parody nothing less than the essential statement of American Jewish tension between them and us, culturally speaking, between affection for the mainstream and alienation from it. When Brooks said about making Blazing Saddles that he was trying to use every Western cliché in the book in the hope that we'll kill them off in the process, he was speaking as the closest possible observer of those clichés and the sharpest possible critic. You can't be the master parodist of the American Western and the American horror movie and the American silent film and the American suspense picture and so on without a deep familiarity and love for the material. And yet, you have to be outside it as well to feel estranged enough from it to point out its flaws, its ridiculous features, its aesthetic omissions, and even its moral failures. In short, you have to be the loyal opposition, which is as good a way of describing a certain American Jewish attitude as any. But Brooks would not be the genius he is if his work didn't raise artistic questions at the highest level, and perhaps his testing of limits, his pushing against constraints, is most powerful and profound when it comes to the questions of suitable and tasteful subjects for comedy itself. It should never be forgotten that Brooks was a major American box office draw for most of the 1970s, far more financially successful than, say, Woody Allen. And for most of that time, and for most of his audience, those questions revolved around vulgarity. The flatulence scene in Blazing Saddles is the "here's looking at you, kid" of American low comedy on film. But for many others then, and for even more now, Brooks's lifelong engagement with the Holocaust as a source of comedy is substantially more significant. Half a century after the producers first astonished and alienated audiences, the questions Brooks raised about the ethics of Jewish comedy feel more resonant today than ever. With Larry David under fire in 2017 for telling a Holocaust joke in the opening monologue on Saturday Night Live, and the troubling employment of, quote, Holocaust humor, unquote, as an alt-right recruitment strategy, Brooks's own Ur-Holocaust comedy seems more important to think about than ever. For someone of Brooks's cultural stature, there are surprisingly few books written about him, and even fewer works dedicated to a sustained treatment of Brooks as a Jewish artist. I hope to correct that omission here in a biography shaped and focused by particular moments, preoccupations, and sensibilities. And speaking of sensibilities, although the thinking and research that have gone into the book are, of course, serious, no book about Mel Brooks should be entirely unfunny. And so, befitting its subject, I'll try to throw in plenty of examples and anecdotes to illustrate one of the most colorful and dynamic lives in American show business. So then what are you waiting for? One can hear the master stage whispering. Get to it already! And so off we go. Chapter 1. A Jew Grows in Brooklyn. In the first years of the 20th century, a Yiddish writer named Avram Raisin wrote a gem of a short story, a little comic tossaway, about a man who went searching for America, but he didn't have the money to get very far, so he got as far as Brooklyn, and that's where he stayed. Looking at the bright lights and the rising skyscrapers of the city from across the East River, that dominating poetic symbol of ambition and engineering modernity, Roebling's Bridge spanning the waters, that was where the Jews made their lives, in the borough's brownstones and cobbled streets. Alfred Kazin would walk the streets of the city. Mel Brooks would float slightly above them, or so he would describe it. Brooks was Amerikaner geboren, the native son of two immigrants. It was a mixed marriage of a sort. Max Kaminsky was part of the German Jewish wave, emigrating from Danzig as a boy, his father starting a booming herring concern on the Lower East Side, while his mother, Kate Brookman, was born in Kiev, coming over at the age of two. Max and Kate met in the city, married in 1916, moved to Brooklyn, and proceeded to produce four boys, Irving, Lenny, Bernie, and Melvin, a quartet that sounds straight out of an American Jewish vaudeville punchline. Young Melvin Kaminsky arrived in the world on June 28, 1926, on the family kitchen table. Home delivery was common in those days. And was only about 2 and a half when his father Max, a paralegal, process server, insurance investigator, and public notary, died of that all-too-common Lower East Side ailment, pulmonary tuberculosis, on January 14, 1929. He was 34. This was a second abandonment for Kate, of sorts. Her father had deserted his family in 1906, one of the many disappeared husbands of the New World, the kind posted on the pages of the Forverts with pictures that looked like mugshots, forcing Kitty and some of her siblings to spend part of their childhood in the Hebrew orphan asylum in what was then Jewish Harlem. Though the extended family helped out, the social safety net being what it wasn't, Kitty Kaminsky, along with all three of Brooks's older siblings, were forced to go to work to make ends meet, in the garment trade as shipping clerks, newspaper sellers, runners. Melvin, of course, was too young to do so, even by the lax child labor standards of the day, with the result that he became, in a familiar dynamic to many Jewish American families of the time, the babied repository of the family's emotions. Loved, loved, loved. I was adored, he would say later. I was always in the air, hurled up and kissed and thrown up in the air again. Until I was six, my feet didn't touch the ground. Giving that up was very difficult in life. Volumes have been written about the role of early familial tragedy in the development of the comedian, the lust for affection and attention, the need to act out and act loud. It's almost impossible to find a purer example of the type than young Melvin, who was talking at 16 months, tumbling with abandon in grade school, and was the undisputed champion of the street corner. With the liberty granted and forced on him by his mother's and siblings' jobs, Brooks took to the streets. We didn't have any trees. The good earth, to me, was cement. Those Brooklyn streets were a classic training ground for the motor-mouthed Jewish kid, short in stature and long in sass, who'd rather use his wits and feet than his fists, but would sometimes have to use all three. Either you were hearing a joke or repeating a joke, Brooks said. Comedy was born on street corners. Jewish street corner alumni included Joe Ansis, who would teach the art of the fast-paced, free-flow, wildman spritz to Lenny Bruce, and Jack Kirby, who'd pugnaciously shape the four-color collective imagination in comics for decades to come. We grew up on those stoops, Brooks would say. We played stoop ball. We'd spread the Jewish newspapers, the Daily Forward, which was like the Jewish New York Times, or the more progressive Freiheit. Yiddish, in other words, was pervasive, literally underfoot, along, of course, with its speakers. I thought Christians were a minority. I really did, Brooks would say, expressing a sensibility, if not an actual belief. Morning, noon, and night, all I ran into were Jews. Understandably, Brooks's Brooklyn neighborhood of Brownsville was estimated to be 75% Jewish the year he was born. Jewish Brooklyn of the time was also, as Brooks would later put it, a hotbed of artistic intellectuality, expressed perhaps most prominently in theater and music. Above all, they loved theater. Those tenement Jews loved books and serious plays, Boris Tomaszewski-type plays. Brooks's choice of Tomaszewski isn't surprising. That grand, stalking figure bestrode the Yiddish stage like a colossus. But his preening physical presence, his love for historical drama, his insistence on the model of actor-slash-manager-slash-director-slash-producer, this was more than an example. Knowingly or no, it would serve Brooks as the first of many artistic templates. And that sense, pervasive in the Yiddish theater, that it wasn't really a play if it didn't have some music in it, spoke to another future essential component. Music was almost woven into the American Jewish immigrant life, and for ambitious and creative Jews, it could provide another entree into the entertainment business as well, via vaudeville and its cinematic adaptations. As Brooks would recall almost three-quarters of a century later, though it was the depths of the Depression, there was music everywhere. Not Vivaldi or Verdi, but the popular music of the day. I knew the lyrics of all of 1935's greatest hits and loudly sang them all day long as I happily danced along the sidewalks. Theater, music, and movies. Like the other Brooklyn-born Jewish comedian-director auteur who would change his name and grow up to dominate film comedy in the 1970s, Melvin grew up in the grand age of movies before, as they put it, the pictures got small. Almost a decade older than Alan Stewart Konigsberg, later better known as Woody Allen, Brooks was old enough to fully inhabit, as a small child, an entertainment world in transition from the silent film to the talkies, Chaplin and Keaton, as well as the jazz singer. This was much better than real life, Brooks said about the movies. Who needs real life? It would not have escaped the family notice that the first commercially successful talkie, released when Melvin was a year old, was deeply connected with Jewishness. The titular jazz singer's attempt to balance the desires and siren song of modern entertainment with fidelity to Jewish identity and tradition was also making it clear from the very beginning that the voice of film was, or at least could be, a Jewish voice. It was a lesson Melvin would take to heart. Of course, even precocious as he was, Melvin was too young to appreciate the jazz singer in its original release, but he did see a Hitchcock film, The Lodger, at 6. He remembered watching it as a little kid in Brooklyn, eating knishes, and Frankenstein, that classic Universal horror film, even before that. It gave him nightmares that the monster was climbing up his fire escape. Was it cheap babysitting, a way of keeping out of trouble? Brooks would sometimes stay at some dump neighborhood theater from opening at 11:30 in the morning till night. Or was it that the notions of family viewing were different then, that mass entertainment was less differentiated by age than it is today? Regardless, Melvin went to the movies religiously, Saturdays at the Marcy Theater. He loved westerns particularly, but also the hijinks of the brothers Marx and Ritz. The latter, who came from the neighborhood, featured a singing and dancing Frankenstein as one of the horror boys from Hollywood in 1936. And perhaps most of all, 1930s musical comedies like the Fred Astaire Ginger Rogers movie Swing Time from that same year, which he'd later call his favorite movie. And the outer borough kid dreamed of the Great White Way, which was everything Manhattan was supposed to be. Sophisticated, cosmopolitan, rich, and of course, more than ever so slightly Gentile. The kind of club that probably wouldn't have wanted him for a member. When we were kids, Brooks would say later, we'd walk across the Williamsburg Bridge to the Lower East Side, and that was okay. There were a lot of Jews there. However, when we'd go any further uptown, it became very scary and very exciting at the same time. Reinforcing the point was a first visit to Broadway at 9 with his Uncle Joe, a philosopher, very deep, very serious, don't buy a cardboard belt, he'd say. A day that Brooks recalled infected me with the virus of the theater. The show was Cole Porter's Anything Goes, and the lead was Ethel Merman, a combination of British gentility and sheer, belting, outer borough moxie. Although the Queens-born Merman hailed from Presbyterian and Episcopal, not Jewish, roots. What's more, the show's title song could have served as an ars poetica for the future auteur of Liberation from Constraint. What was once shocking in olden days is no longer apropos. These days, anything goes. Brooks would sing and dance around this point, shifting it subtly, but this musical, and musicals generally, settled deep into his DNA, and, in the process, unearthed a calling. Way up there, at the top of the second balcony, I figured that I was as close to heaven as I'd ever get, he later reminisced. On the way home, still buzzing with the excitement from the show, I made up my mind. I said, I am going into show business, and nothing will stop me. And soon after Melvin's bar mitzvah, when the family moved to Brighton Beach, he found his instrument. The drums seem a perfect match for the man who would become Mel Brooks, capable of drawing all the attention in the room, making a crash and a bang, but also capable of tight, close rhythm. The drums are also, generally speaking, an instrument that follows the melody, amplifies and backbeats around it, rather than coming up with the melody itself. They are, in some sense, a perfect instrument for a parodist. Not to mention being great for the comic rimshot. They are, far and away, the most popular instrument for comedians to play, Steve Martin's banjo and Woody Allen's clarinet notwithstanding. Melvin's experience with drum lessons both echoed the tight-knit nature of the American Jewish community, where it seemed everyone knew everyone, and prefigured a career marked by constant proximity to and involvement with the great and the good. A nearby neighbor in Brighton Beach named Buddy Rich, the older brother of Brooks's high school bandmate, offered to give the teenage Brooks drum lessons. And the guy had yichus, a pedigree. He'd played in Artie Shaw's big band, as high a recommendation as you could get. It's not clear that Melvin's musical abilities actually required the masterful talents of one of the most famous drummers of the 20th century. And it's not clear how often or how long Rich actually taught him. But it sufficed. Enough for him to play weddings and bar mitzvahs under the name Melvin Brooks, claiming the reason for the shortened version of his mother's original name was that something longer didn't fit on the bass drum, but probably also because he kept getting confused with the jazz musician Max Kaminsky. Enough to help him get the break behind his big break. Many years later, as Brooks told the story when he made Blazing Saddles, Rich embraced him weeping. "You're going to be a movie director," he said. "So?" Brooks asked, wondering at his tears. "You could have been a good drummer," Rich replied. Brooks's career path sometimes seems so perfectly cast it feels more like a metaphor than actual biography, epitomizing the history of American Jewish comedy, American Jewry, in the 20th century. And, in its own ways, it combines a trailblazing nature with a sense of belatedness. Like the work of all great parodists, it has to follow simultaneously with leading. Brooks was frequently, in the early days, a little too young for the main event, playing to his advantage and creating guilt simultaneously. He plays while his older siblings work, and when the Second World War broke out, he was too young, at least in the war's early years, to enlist. But he started to help earn his share at an early age, and he did so in the most American Jewish manner possible, by going to the mountains. The Borscht Belt was at its height then, with families flocking to the Catskills to escape the city heat for the week, their working and sweltering fathers riding up to join them on the weekends for heaping portions of food and entertainment. In 1940, the 14-year-old Brooks got a job at Sullivan County's Butler Lodge via a Williamsburg acquaintance, the social director of the nearby Avon Lodge. It was mostly menial work in the kitchen and the boathouse, $8 a week plus room and board, and for a while he was assigned, and this is not a joke, to the sour cream station. But on the side, he begins to entertain. The tumbler is an almost impossible phenomenon to fully describe in all its low majesty. Someone who makes sure that everyone is having fun makes it sound like a cruise director with a clipboard. Someone who walks around doing funny things makes it sound more extraneous to the mountain phenomenon than it was. Performance artist is closer, but it omits the sense of the viewer's involvement by virtue of being tumult. Brooks, of course, has the perfect definition, a busboy with tinsel in his blood. The tumbler is atmospheric, reminding the hotel guests that they are in a different space, a world in which comedy can bust out at any time. Something, in fact, like the world certain film characters inhabit. At least, this must have been the sense of anyone sitting by the pool of the Butler Lodge in the summer of 1940, who could have seen, on numerous occasions, a young boy dressed in something that could have been a remarkably ill-fitting black alpaca coat and derby walk onto the diving board, holding two cardboard suitcases filled with rocks. With a primordial wail, the call of the nebbish, "Business is terrible, I can't go on!" the young man would drop into the pool, suit, suitcases, and all. The commitment to the bit, to the comedy, to the fact that performance and life were all tied up together in a very serious way was the fact that Melvin could not swim, and so had to be fished out by lifeguards after each performance. "Look, I had to take chances, or it wasn't fun being funny," he'd later say. But really, would you expect anything less? Brooks had a commitment to painful and dangerous comedy from the first. It gleamed in the first sketch he ever wrote for a Saturday show at the Butler the following summer. It was a two-hander, Brooks and a young woman. He, claiming he's a masochist, asks her, a self-professed sadist, to hit him. She complies. Brooks's response, wait a minute, hold it, I think I'm a sadist. Adept in the language of psychological neurosis, yes. Short, snappy, and funny, yes. And also, not insignificantly, requiring Brooks to take a blow every time it's performed. Analysts, take note. But Brooks had not broken through as a performer yet, or a writer, by any means. The summer after that, in 1942, he was in show business, but very much in a support capacity. He wasn't a comedian, but thanks to his drum lessons, he was able to sit behind the comedians, provide them with support, rim shots mostly. Behind, however, was never a position that sat well for too long with Brooks, and one night, when the comic was sick, Mel went on in his place. The first night was a stale retread of the house comic's act, but the second night was magic. The story goes that before the fabled performance, there'd been an episode that set the entire hotel abuzz. Molly the chambermaid had gotten locked in a closet. "Los mira Royce! Let me out!" she shouted, until someone came to her rescue. The next night, that was how young Melvin Kaminsky began his act, with a Yiddish yawp of a demand for self-liberation to let the harness off, and that was that. The audience was eating out of his hand, and he had learned the power of the contemporaneous, of the ad-lib based on the moment. It's just, you've got to repeat it louder and faster. He stayed the house comic for the rest of the season. But even with Melvin's success, he was, of course, a minor player, at best, in the starry firmament of the hotel entertainment hierarchy. There were masses of comedic cannon fodder thrown at the constantly starving audience, in both senses of the word. And when it came to musicians-turned-comedians, there was no contest. The Avon, not the Butler, was the place to look, where a former saxophonist with a God's gift of double talk had viewers packed around the porch lights and peering through the windows as he held forth. There was no way that Melvin Kaminsky could hold a candle to Sid Caesar. The man was just born gifted. The strength, the performance chops, the voice, even the name, unbelievably naturally his by birth, the most perfect Gentile performer's name you could imagine. But that wasn't too much of a problem, because no one could hold a candle to Caesar. It was like being jealous of the lightning. Years later, Brooks would recall, Sid was the Apollo of the mountains, the best-looking guy since silent movies. He would stretch himself out on a rock near a lake, and we'd all stand and look at him. Their paths crossed at the time, briefly, but only as acquaintances, the star and the star-struck. The idols of the Borscht Belt, the most Jewish space in America, were, as everyone understood in their kishkas with a twisted irony, born of anti-Semitic restriction. They won't let us into their hotels, so we'll make our own, with more food and better fun. And everyone understood also the furnace of anti-Semitism that powered the Nazi regime in Europe. Like many others in the mountains and in Eastern District High School, the family had moved once again in the interim from Brighton Beach back to Williamsburg, Melvin had extended family in Nazi-occupied Europe. And whatever he and his community knew precisely about the contours of the war against the Jews, they knew it wasn't good. Even closer to home, all of his three brothers were in the service, two of them overseas. His brother Lenny was shot down over Austria in 1944 and held as a POW for the remainder of the war. He'd managed to pass as Polish, since if he'd been identified as Jewish by the Nazis, things might have gone far, far worse for him. Melvin hated Nazis for good reason and with a passion, an animating hatred that would continue throughout his career, and he enlisted as soon as he turned 18, following all his brother's examples. The same week, Leonard went MIA. That was June 1944, the month of D-Day. By virtue of his age, Brooks's wartime service was necessarily shorter than many others. For Brooks, like many other big-city Jews of his era, the Army was a formative and sustained encounter with non-Jewish America, and although he claimed to love it, it was where he learned to eat a cheeseburger and dance the waltz with beautiful Southern belles. It wasn't always pretty. Sent to the Virginia Military Institute for training and more specialized technical skills thanks to a high score on an Army classification test, he was called a dirty Jew in the commissary line. He went for the guy with his mess kit, being a tough Jew from Brooklyn. The program he was in at the VMI disbanded, and Brooks ended up finishing basic training at Fort Sill, Oklahoma. By the time he did, Paris was already liberated, which is not to say he didn't see action. It shouldn't be forgotten in all the conversation about Brooks and Nazis that he actually fought them. Brooks landed at Le Havre in February of 1945 and was a forward observer for the military and part of the 1104th Engineer Combat Group. He remembered seeing bodies along the roadside, wrapped up in mattress covers and stacked in a ditch, and ordering the old men and little boys the Germans sent against the Allies at the war's end to throw down their guns and surrender in a mixture of German and Yiddish. He also responded to Nazi propaganda announcements by singing Tut-Tut-Tutsie back at them via bullhorn. But his main role, particularly after VE Day and a promotion to corporal, he was holed up in a wine cellar near Wiesbaden the day Germany surrendered, was as a non-com entertainment specialist in special services, which were essentially GI tumblers for the American military still in Germany. Brooks scheduled USO tours and amateur soldier productions alike for whole divisions, sometimes acting as master of ceremonies, during which, for the first time, at least in public, he tried out his Hitler impersonation and saw a four-photo spread of himself mugging and pulling faces appear in Stars and Stripes. He was 19 years old. Brooks finished his hitch stateside in spring 1946, back in New Jersey as Fort Dix's head of entertainment, where he and two friends were most notable for their hairy-legged, unshaven version of the Andrews sisters, performing the songs of the popular wartime trio to delighted audiences. But that wasn't Melvin Kaminsky's only musical effort. He had his own theme song, which he presented to the audience in that jazz singer Al Jolson hand-on-heart approach. Da-da-da-da-da-da! Here I am. I'm Melvin Brooks. I've come to stop the show. Just a ham who's minus looks, but in your hearts I'll grow. I'll tell you gags. I'll sing you songs. Just happy little snappy songs that roll along. Out of my mind. Won't you be kind? And please, love, Melvin Brooks. From the perspective of a literary critic, or for that matter, a psychobiographer, it's all there, isn't it? The need for attention and affection, the concern about personal appearance, the Ars Manifesto as an ad libber, the songs roll along out of my mind, unless it's simply that he's out of his mind, the mixture of music and comedy. Brooks, like many of the most successful commercial artists, understood exactly who he was from the very beginning. An essential part of which, of course, was a performer, a man of the theater who's come to stop the show, and who needs the audience to make up their mind, to change their mind, from their first, perhaps negative impression. If this reminds you of the plot of The Producers, you're getting warm. But Brooks had a way to go in the theater first. He'd returned to Butler in the summer of 1946, this time as a veteran social director, in both senses of that word. But that felt like a dead end, out of the spotlight. The next year, after some brief stints as a postal courier and a ladies' wear salesman at the Abilene Blouse and Dress Company, and perhaps a very little bit of time in classes, Brooklyn College, which he frequently claimed to attend, has no records of him matriculating, Brooks joined the Red Bank Players, a New Jersey theater group, that summer. His time there would set a pattern repeated on many future occasions, starting in a minor role in the institution and then expanding his ambit. He began as a stagehand and then, when the director quit near the end of the summer, took over that role, where he blossomed. But New Jersey was still Jersey, small time, when city lights beckoned, like the ones around the Copacabana, where Caesar was starring in a revue. Whether or not it was indeed, as Barry Manilow would later assert, the hottest spot north of Havana, the Copa had plenty of heat. That same summer, 1947, Groucho Marx and Carmen Miranda starred in a movie that shared the nightclub's name. Although the film didn't quite capture the actual club sizzle, the Times reviewer, Bosley Crowther, suggested that it was furnished with all the usual fixtures of a Hollywood nightclub film, meaning chorus girls, musical numbers, cardboard characters, and an idiotic plot. Its ingredients, mixed differently, became a recipe for significantly more accomplished films later on. Brooks, by contrast, was trying to peddle one-page headshots all over town, even busting into Uber producer Kermit Blumgarden's office under the pretense that he was the Yiddish theater actor turned movie star Paul Muni. When Blumgarden saw him, he said, "This boy is not Paul Muni." Brooks, not missing a beat, responded, "Muni's name is Harold Gottwald. I am the real Paul Muni." The joke went around and around since Muni had changed his real name from Muni Weisenfreund, and for that matter, Brooks had changed his. Emblematic of the period's blurred and constantly refashioning American Jewish identities in the entertainment world. Blumgarden got the joke, even savored it. "You got a lot of moxie, kid. I'm going to remember you," Brooks recalled him saying. But it didn't get him a gig. Now, it was different with Caesar. The Copa headliner, like his Roman namesake, was always someone who enjoyed being worshipped. And Brooks, in the market for a father figure, was someone who...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.